Wow, they cut off my video. Oh my goodness. Darn. They mess with my video a lot, unfortunately. But they finally cut it off. Usually they it's like, messing up and then come back on, but this time it was messing up and then they cut it off. Darn, sorry about that. Apologies. But the topic, May 17th is the day of Pentecost. Talk to your church, Christians and church leaders, okay, to the day of Pentecost. Okay, are we going to do an event concerning as a body of Christ in one accord to celebrate the day of Pentecost on May 17th? Or at least try to celebrate it May 16th on a Sunday. I mean, it's the day of Pentecost, But that's another message that that's not going to happen and has not been happening, that this church system has not been celebrating the day of Pentecost, the fulfillment of the establishment of the church in Acts 2. Is the horrible disaster of, of why Apostle Paul said men will not endure sound doctrine. It's so bad that this church system has not been celebrating the day of Pentecost. I mean, it's a horrible reality of Christianity, or as us supposed to be being a church, the body of Christ, that we're not celebrating the very day that is supposed to be fulfillment. Like I told people that the church was established in the Lord's Supper that God did, took communion with the disciples. That was the establishment of the church, when they took bread, that was establishment. And 50 days from there was the fulfillment of what was established concerning what Jesus Christ. But that's why we take the Lord's communion. We take the Lord's communion because that's when the church was established. That Jesus says, "This is my body." It's supposed to be His body, and it's not supposed to be this your building and your religious organization controlled by denominational church. No, it's supposed to be His body, that is broken for us. But they, this church system take communion like this is their building. No, it's God's body, But that's another message right there. But the church was established on Passover, and 50 days from Passover was the fulfillment of the Holy Ghost empowering them, speaking of tongues, them baptizing with fire. As what John the Baptist says, John the Baptist baptized with water, but he will baptize you with fire. That fire came from the 50 days of Passover, and the fulfillment of the baptism of the power of the Holy Ghost happened on the day of Pentecost, the day of Pentecost. And Pentecost is May 17th. One of many Christians know that, and I encourage you to tell Christians and tell church leaders, okay, Pentecost is coming. Where's the celebration? When? But watch this. You cannot celebrate the day of Pentecost truly unto God, unto Jesus Christ, unless it be in one accord with a body. You know what I'm saying? Not with a buildings over here or with the ministry, but with a body, that we can only celebrate the day of Pentecost as a body. But the topic of this message, since my message were, cut off, is the reality of your answer versus God's answer. Now, what is that talking about? Your answer versus God's answer, man. Man, I can pick a lot of stories in the Bible to really show this. I mean, really is what, that needs to be understood concerning having a relationship with God. is what's supposed to be the objective of being a Christian through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, is to establish a relationship with God. And God has clearly, from, like I said, from Genesis, you know, throughout the Bible, has showed throughout men and women of God concerning what he desires. That's the key thing. He desires concerning if it has anything to do with him, you know, is what's supposed to be the scenario we're supposed to get, like I said, through the stories of throughout the Old Testament, lived out examples between Noah, Abraham, you know, Isaac, Jacob, you know, Joseph, and everybody that we read in the stories of the Bible. They're supposed to teach us to understand God's answer, you know, or first of all, understand God. You know, first you understand God as what we know, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, all thy mind, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. You know, we're supposed to learn to love God. When we love God, we're supposed to, the ideal of having a relationship is supposed to know the person of who this person is. Not, unfortunately, this church system, they present God and Jesus as, you know, like I say, a genie in a bottle, that these people all about fulfilling your wishes and, or you're giving you blessings. You know, they call it fulfilling your wishes, and you just pray and ask this and they'll give it to you. You know, it's what sad reality is, half of the ideal aspect of God. Not saying that they won't do that. They won't reward you or bless you or, you know, give you things. Yes, they will, but not as, unfortunately, this religious organization controlled by denominational preachers and teachers have been teaching people how God does things. You know, I was riding with my aunt and I was listening to a preacher on there. And I, you know, he was preaching just as the half of the situation, you know. And the guy said on there, he said, well, God is a rewarder. You know, it's like, yep, I agree with that. He's like, he's a rewarder and he rewards us with good. You know, he said he reward us with good. Now, I said, auntie, but the way he was saying, he's saying that God only rewards us with only things that are good. And I was like, well, and I just said, I disagree to my aunt. You know, she was taking us to go purchase vehicles. I want to thank my auntie Knight for doing that. But I was like, no, well, it's Galatians 6 and 7 and 8. It says, be not deceived. God is not mocked. What a person soweth, they shall also reap. If they sow in the flesh, they shall reap corruption. If they sow from the spirit, they shall reap everlasting life. God rewards people, but he's going to reward them based upon what they sow. You know, that's how he works, you know, how he worked all the way from Genesis, you know. That's why he told Noah that he's going to flood the earth, because the world was wicked and evil and they sold evil. You know, the world sold evil. So now they have to reap what they sold concerning the flood, you know, of the earth, is what the ideal that God has been doing throughout human history and never stopped. He never stopped. And the thing is, and unfortunately, you know, like I said, this church system tried to make people think that, oh, God just reward us with all this good stuff and wars of the house and the car and this and or the, like, the wife or the husband, husband for the wife, and just reward and just, you know, just being a genie, you know, a viewpoint that is the sad reality. Most Christians perceive God in that way, but the word of God clearly from Genesis to Revelation see a whole nother different person, you know, that he, yes, he blesses. And if you do not follow his instructions concerning the word of God, you will bring a curse, unfortunately, to yourself. You know, it's supposed to be the rules that God has already established before the beginning of the earth. You know, is what supposed to be the ideal perspective of God. But unfortunately, the people love the ideal of the genie in the bottle God perspective, and I sort of kind of don't have to follow his instructions of the word of God, but he'll still bless me with all this and give me all that, is what most Christians' perspective of God. But, you know, that's what this message is all about. But I want to give you an example, you know, of your answer versus God's answer, because people are praying for God and they want answers, you know. I want to use, I love the example of Elijah concerning, you know, the one, Elijah concerning the, after he done killed 450 prophets of Baal, and now he's praying for rain to come. I mean, he brought fire down from heaven and killed them, and now he's praying for rain to come. And then he sent the servant over there, and the servant came back and said, "See no cloud." He sent him 7 times over there. See, the people was expecting, I guarantee, God to bam, rain, flood, right there. But God didn't do that. You know, God, the prophet Elijah sent a servant there, you know, and the servant went 7 times. Wait a minute, that's God's number. The servant went 7 times, and then watch this. You know, all of a sudden, they're like, okay. And, you know, I guarantee the northern Israel people were like, okay, the rain finna come, because we know that we have a true prophet doing something, because the true prophet brought fire down from heaven and he killed the 450 prophets of Baal. See, he showed forth the power of God. So, you know, the northern Israel people were like, okay, it's going to start raining. And then all of a sudden, a cloud comes of a size of a man's hand. And it's like, what? A cloud of the size of a man's hand? What? We praying for rain and a cloud of the size of a man's hand? That I did many messages on that, but I'm not going to go there. But God gave his answer. And, you know, men are not our flesh. Let me say this from the get-go. Our flesh is not going to like God's spiritual answers. Let me say that again. Our flesh is not going to like God's spiritual answers. That's what you're going to discover throughout all the stories in the Bible. That our flesh is like, what? Huh? What you mean? You know, our, unfortunately, Romans 8 and 6, to be carnal minded is death. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. It requires a spiritual mind to understand and receive God's answers. You cannot, it will be very difficult to try to receive God's answers in the flesh. Now, I want to use this example. I like the movie The Karate Kid, you know, and the idea of the Daniel Russo wanted to learn karate. And he wanted to learn karate because he was being bullied by, you know, a guy that, you know karate. And, you know, and he, like, you know, he wanted to learn karate. So, you know, he asked Mr. Miyagi, "Can I learn karate?" And Mr. Miyagi said, "Okay." So Mr. Miyagi, like, "Paint my, you know, walls over here and paint them like this and that and wax these cars right here, wax on, wax off like this, carefully do that, and keep doing that." And it's like Daniel Russo thought he was working for him to, like, pay for his karate lessons. His perspective of, he's looking at it that way. He's thinking, but Mr. Miyagi kept telling him, gave him a message. I like that part when Mr. Daniel Russo read the message that gave Daniel Russo his instructions. He had to read his instructions. Okay. Read his instructions. And Daniel Russo gets mad. Ah! I can't believe this. I'm tired of this painting these walls. I'm painting this fence. I'm tired of these waxing these cars and frustration. You know, Daniel Russo remind us about who he reminds us, that person in the mirror when it comes to God. God, I asked for a blessing. God, I asked for a miracle. God, and you ain't did nothing. You ain't doing nothing. We do that, right? Well, here's at, and then, you know, Daniel Russo confronts Mr. Miyagi of the situation. And Mr. Miyagi, just how God will do it, said, you know, the reason why I'm telling you to paint is that is the training. That is the training of you learning karate. And that, and waxing wax off, that is the training. And he had to give the revelation, oh boy, he had to give the revelation to Daniel Russo concerning how he, his, how Mr. Miyagi answered. See, Daniel Russo looked it for his answer that he's going, hey, you know, learning, you know. But Mr. Miyagi was giving his answer. See, his answer wasn't Daniel's answer. And that's what happens with Christians, unfortunately, concerning that they praying for God to do this, pray for God to do that. And then, bam, God gives his answer. And one thing about God's answers, it will be all about, based upon, is somebody following my instructions. That's one reason. If the reason why an answer from God comes in a certain way that is inconvenient is because of someone is not learning his instructions. Someone is not trying to learn who he is. You know what I'm saying? As what Jesus said in Matthew 11:29, Jesus says, take my yoke, not your yoke, that you, your view of how you want to see Jesus Christ. He said, take my yoke and learn of him. You know what I'm saying? Is what, unfortunately, Christians are not understanding, you know, and unfortunately it's sad that we can read Matthew, Mark, Luke, John and see Jesus Christ's performance and still think that Jesus Christ is half of the ideal perspective that this church system, unfortunately, put Jesus Christ out there. You know, I was meditating the other day. You know, it's like the idea we can read about Jesus Christ going to the temple and seeing those money changers in there, and bam, Jesus Christ didn't speak. We don't read that he said something to the money changers. You know, Jesus Christ didn't, you know, say, you know, come up there. Politician, you know, Jesus Christ wasn't no politician, of course. He didn't say, well, what are y'all doing with these, selling these, doves and lambs? I mean, how much y'all selling them for? And how much y'all doing this? And what are you doing this for of selling? He didn't have no discussion. There was no conversation about it. But the Lamb of God, when he saw something that was wrong with the temple of God, came about. You know what's interesting about this? It doesn't say that where did Jesus get a whip from? That's what I want to find out. I want to find out where did Jesus get the whip from? I mean, Jesus, because Jesus coming into Jerusalem. I mean, he coming to the temple and, you know, it's like he goes and see that, oh, they're making the house of prayer a den of thieves. Where did he get the whip from? That would be a quite interesting question to ask Jesus. But anyway, but he managed to find a whip. And he finds the whip and he's whipping the money changers out of the temple of the Lord. That is his response concerning something is wrong in the temple of God. Or something is wrong with something that's concerning the things of God. That's Jesus' response. But most Christians, no, that's not their response. They will come into these church buildings and praise God, worship God, love God, and love God, and not say, this is wrong. Wait a minute, something's wrong with this church. Something's wrong with what's going on here. You know what I'm saying? That's not the response of most Christians, but we can see Jesus Christ bam, going in the temple, said something's wrong. And we could see Jesus Christ going postal and coming at the scribes and Pharisees, these religious organizations, you know, in his day, and speaking against them, calling them calling them hypocrites, of serpents, vipers, you know what I'm saying? All the time. But yet it's okay for a church system to be named a religious organization that is all about division and things that are contrary to the scriptures. I mean, that Jesus Christ's performance here, but this performance going on right now that many people are doing, is drastic concerning Jesus Christ. And it's like people like, God, Jesus Christ, give us an answer. Jesus Christ, give us an answer. No, we already have the answer. We need to follow his instructions. Follow what the, take his yoke and learn of him. If you want the things of Jesus Christ, you, the aim and goal is supposed to be being more like Jesus Christ. It's to Matthew 16:24 is to deny yourself, pick up your cross, follow him. Galatians 2:20, to be crucified with Christ, that no longer you live, no longer you live, no longer you live, but Christ live in you. You know that you, John 3:30, increase of Jesus and decrease of yourself, and that you follow his instructions, that blessed are those that are persecuted for righteousness sake, for there's the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says if they hate him, they will hate you. You know what I'm saying? Christians wondering why people are hating. They like, why people don't like when I speak the word of God, when I sing the word of God, why people don't like me. They wondering why, most Christians, you know, or, you know, they think they're supposed to be like, when Jesus clearly said that we're supposed to be hated. And Jesus said that we're not of this world, you know, and it's like Jesus Christ giving us these answers. He's given us these answers, and Jesus Christ, he's the way, the truth, and the life. John 4:24, God is the spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. You know, truth is supposed to be the ideal aspect of being of Christ concerning Christianity. But people can come out with lies and false teaching and stuff like that, and fables, and deem as being representations of Jesus Christ. I mean, this opposite. We because now people have their answer. They have, unfortunately, based upon this world system and this religious organization, they want to ask God for this and ask Jesus for that. But God and Jesus is giving them their, well, first of all, you must realize they already gave you the answers. That the answer is supposed to be simply follow his instructions according to the word of God. That is supposed to be the answer, period, point blank, you know. But people don't like that answer because that comes against the flesh. But Jesus said, Matthew 26:41, the spirit is willing to do what the word of God says to get God's answer, you know, but the flesh is too weak, you know, it's too weak to be about getting God's answer. You know, God, Jesus answered that he must die on the cross for our sins. He must suffer, you know, betrayal and being denied and being rejected, disrespected, 39 lashes, crown of thorns on his head. That is the answer to sin, to the sin problem of this world. That's God's answer. It's an ugly answer in the flesh, but it's in the spirit. It's beautiful. That I did a message about the beauty of holiness. Like people, that's the beauty of holiness. When you suffer for the sake of the truth of God's word concerning the flesh, that's the beauty of holiness. But that's another message. But anyway, well, God's answer will not be our answer. If our answer is based upon the flesh, it ain't going to probably be God's answer. God's answer is based upon the spirit, and the answer is supposed to be whatever is going to be about getting everybody to Genesis 1:26, being made in the image and the likeness of God. That's what supposed to be the objective of being more like Jesus Christ is all about. Made in the image and the likeness of God, operating in spirit and truth, is the answer of what the objective of the word of God is. But anything else that's concerning this obtaining people and the things of this earth is something false. It's something false. Now, yes, God will bless. Yes, God will bless people, send people around you. But when they send people around you, to get you in relationship with him. If he sends things around you, he bless you with something for the sake of get you in relationship with him. You know what I'm saying? And to follow his instructions. That's what they're for. They're not for you to just, be a part of things as well. All right, that's the message. Hope you got it. Hope it makes sense to you. Be blessed. I hope you understand the difference between your answers and God's answers. Be blessed. God be glory, and forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen.